Dear friends, in previous lecture one, I enlightened you on various liabilities under tort, joint liability, several liability, constructive liability, strict liability, state liability, absolute liability, no fault liability, all these things. But it is given to understand that since that lecture was recorded by some students in the lecture hall, it is not clear. If you use a cell phone, earphone, everything will be clear. Dear friends, in this connection, I want to express my heartfelt thanks and gratitude for readily accepting my works. Because of your help and cooperation, I would able to write almost all books on law. The books became very popular all over the country and outside the country also. So it is my duty to express my heartfelt thanks and gratitude for your consistent cooperation and help for what I am now. Now another thing is, I sincerely request you to communicate about my lectures online to all your friends. Some of you are very talented people in computer operation and Android phone operation. I humbly request you to do your best for getting my lectures popularized, so that I will have inspiration to deliver more and more lectures. In a matter of fact, I don't have more equipment for recording and all. Directly I'm recording in cell phone, and my son is putting it in YouTube. So there are any problems, kindly cooperate and bear with the loss. And if you use earphone, it will be very clear. For better clarity, you please use your earphone. And I once again request you to inform the brother. Now, the next chapter for discussion is vicarious liability. Vicarious liability means if one person commits tort, other person is put to liability. The liability of the other person, that is latter, is called vicarious liability. The driver of a lorry or bus commits an accident. The master is put to liability. That liability of a master, owner of the lorry, is called vicarious liability. There are so many cases. This vicarious liability can be discussed under two ways: private service, public. Vicarious liability under private service, vicarious liability under public service, government service. Private service, there are some instances: master and servant, employer, independent contractor, firm, partners. Master, servant, employer, independent contractor, principal, agent, firm and partners. Master and servant. Then government service, only pure state government service and the central government service are taken into consideration. Quasi-governments like insurance corporations, banks, universities, companies or public limited companies will not be taken into account. Only pure civil servants or public servant, that is state government employees or public government, police officers, judicial officers, revenue officers, postal officials, only the pure government servants are considered as. So now, in one chapter, we discuss about master and vicarious liability of master for torts committed by the servant. In next chapter, we discuss about the vicarious liability of a state for the torts committed by its servant. When master is liable, when master is not liable. Whether it is a private service or public government service, master is put to liability for the tort committed by servant for the reason of some special relationship lies between master and servant. Some special relationship lies between employer and independent contractor. But ultimate beneficiary is the master in getting the work performed by the servant. That is why master is put to liability for the tort committed by the servant. This chapter I will explain in detail in a separate class. In some next lecture, after in the second lecture, I will let you know What is what? What this second the Vicarious Celebrity speaks about? What's declared? What are the chapters speak about in 3 to 5 minutes? But after completion of covering all the chapters, and the next third lecture where I will take up some most important and burning chapters, and in one lecture I will cover, I will try to cover 2-3 chapters. So that if I continue complete some 5 to 6 lectures, I will be able to complete overall syllabus is a tentatively. Basing on that, you can attend classes regularly and develop your knowledge from wonderful lectures from your teachers. If you have some knowledge about the subject, if you attend the class, you can have inspiration, you can have more interest to hear it, to extend attention towards the lecture. That is why this will be very useful. Now coming to the topic, private service this, government service this. Why government is liable? Because of some, one master is liable for tort committed by servant because of some special relationship. Similarly, in government service, the vicarious private service, vicarious liability of master and servant, we study in one chapter. Government liability for the torts committed by servant, we will study in another separate chapter. Now, what is the main reason why one person commits tort? Why others should be made liable? What is the source for it? What is the source? So just like Dharma Sutras, just like equity principle, there are some Latin maxims in common law. So those there are some actio personalis moritor comes to persona, securitur tuit non ladis, like that. There are two Latin maxims. What are the two Latin maxims? Qui facit per alium facit per se. This means he who does an act through another deemed in law do it himself. Suppose I have some property, I have some lorry or bus or some any car or anything. If I have to use that vehicle on my own. I should drive the, suppose I purchased a lorry for commercial purpose, I should drive it. Suppose I purchase a car for some commercial purpose or personal purpose, I must use it. I have my own car, I don't drive. I have to drive my own car, I don't drive. I employ some driver. If the driver commits any accident causing any injury, damage, the master will be liable. So that is why, similarly, when agent commits any tort, principal will be liable. If firm or partner commits any tort, firm as a whole will be liable. Employer and independent contractor. Who is employer? Who is independent contractor? Suppose in university, the university authorities wanted to construct one big administrative building. For that purpose, they have engaged some qualified engineer. That engineer is called independent contractor. For construction of the building, he will engage some 100 workers. Suppose the master-servant relationship lies between employer and that independent contractor and workers, not between university and the workers. So, if any tort is committed by the workers while taking the process of construction, that independent contractor is to be liable. Of course, there are some exceptions to this rule. We will discuss that matter in respect to chapter strict liability. Now, employer independent. For principal agent. Principal and agent, for all practical purpose, they are of same status. But agent is a person who acts on behalf of the principal. But in master and servant relationships, servant is weaker. Master is the superior. But in principal and agent status will be the same. When the agent is one who is appointed by the principal to act on his work, the agent while doing the work commits any wrong, master will be liable. Then next one is firm and partners. For the ideal of partnership is all partners act for one, every partner acts for all. So there is a mutual agency is there, one for all and all for one. So with that ideal only they carry on business. Suppose any partner commits any tort causing injury or damage, the aggrieved party can file a case against the firm as a whole. That is employer, that is firm and partner. Principal agent, firm and partner, employer, independent contractor, master and servant. These are the different systems. So there are the two maxims are qui facit per alium facit per se mean, he who does an act to another deemed in law do it himself mean, when I have a car or lorry or bus, I have to drive it on my own. If I engage anybody, employ anybody for driving purpose, if any tort, any wrong committed by him deemed to have been committed by me, I must pay, okay, I must meet the consequences. Then master is liable. That is first thing. Second thing is respondent superior. Second maximum is one. First one is facit per avalium, facit per se. Second one is respondent superior. Respondent superior. Respondent superior means let the superior responsible. When a tort is committed, in that case, they have two persons have connection to that. Two persons, one is stronger and other weaker. Other weaker, let us put liability on the stronger so that the aggrieved party will be able to get the remedy, get the relief. Suppose lorry driver commits an accident, some pedestrian is seriously injured or died, for to pay compensation to the widow or the next or kith or kin, if case is filed on against the owner will be able to meet the consequences, he will be able to pay the compensation. If this case is filed on driver, he won't be able to do anything. He would get prepared to go to jail and he cannot do anything. So here the thing to be born in your mind is master is liable for tort committed by servant means the servant, it doesn't mean that servant is not liable. Servant is liable. Servant will have civil liability and criminal liability. At the same time, master will have liability. That master's liability is called vicarious liability. Today, master pays compensation on behalf of the driver, and tomorrow he will recover his service or other arrangement he will make. He will not keep quiet. But so suppose if any person died, the driver will be arrested and put in prison. Under section 304A, he may be imprisoned up to 3 years imprisonment or what, all the consequences, he will do it. But when the master and servant relationship is there, the master will have only civil liability. Master is have no criminal liability. Suppose the driver killed by committed accident and killed a pedestrian, then he will be sent to the prison, he will undergo imprisonment. Master will not be arrested, master will not be put in imprisonment. So that is why it is said that vicarious liability is unknown to criminal law. Suppose a tailoring shop is there, the tailor is a very famous tailor, and there is a button stitching boy has stolen one suit and ran away. Then the owner of the suit will come and ask, where is my clothes? Then he has to pay. He has to pay the cost of that suit. But in case that boy is caught, he is arrested and he is put in prison for theft, master will not do it. So however, there are some exceptional cases. Master will have criminal liability provided the act of tort or any crime of the servant is done with the consultation of the master. Then the master's position is like an avatar. Avatar in the sense, one who engages another to commit a crime is avatar. Commit a crime is avatar. Suppose adulteration of material. Suppose the general shop is there. All provisions are there. If any provision in rice is adulterated, wheat is adulterated, all these things are adulterated. In consultation with the master, if inspection squad visits the shop and detected adulteration of foods and other commodities, the master will be held liable. If the servant is questioned, I have done it with the consultation of master, then master also will have the civil and criminal liability. This is about vicarious liability. When master is liable, when master is not liable, these aspects we will study in detail in the separate chapter. The purpose of this lecture is to let you know what chapter this vicarious liability speak about this. Then the next chapter is vicarious liability of a state. Vicarious liability of state or government, both are same. The government today is engaged in so many activities, including commercial activities. So the government servants work on behalf of the government. Suppose every central government servant, the contract with all central government servants enter into contracts on behalf of the President of India, and all state government government employees enter into contract on behalf of the governor. So in this process, whether it is a contractual obligation or whether it is for a contractual obligation or tortious obligation, while discharging the duties, the government official while travelling the vehicle dashed somebody, caused an injury, and other areas, there are so many instances in which, in addition to breach of contract, torts also may take place. When the government servant while discharging his duties commits a tort, when government, when he government is liable, when government is not liable. These are the things. So for this purpose, the government is a sovereign. So the traditional rule is that the king can do no wrong. Suppose the king is not answerable in his own courts, if king commits wrong, he is exempted from the liability. That exemption is called immunity from liability. That immunity from liability is called because the king is sovereign. That is called sovereign immunity. Sovereign immunity means exemption from criminal liability to the sovereign or king. So that means similarly, the state is exempted from criminal liability, provided some conditions are satisfied. Number one, the tort is committed by the servant in discharge of his duty or obligations imposed on him by law. That is one thing. Second condition is this discharge of duties under some sovereign delegation, sovereign power. Now, in government, what is sovereign, what is non-sovereign, it was detected in 1860 in Peninsular and Oriental Sea Navigation vs. Secretary of State for India. In that case, Chief Justice of Calcutta High Court, Peacock. In those days, there was no Supreme Court. Calcutta, Bombay and Madras, these were the three presidency town. In three presidency towns, so high courts were there. From this appeal, if anybody wanted to go on appeal, he had to go to London, where Privy Council was there. It is joint prefix court for Indian Territory and UK. Then, that Chief Justice Peacock coined what is sovereign, what is non-sovereign. There is no any clarity about what is sovereign, what is non-sovereign even today. Sovereign functions means, according to that, those functions which government alone should discharge, they are sovereign functions. Some function which can be discharged by any other private body, they are non-sovereign functions. For example, army, navy, air force, judiciary, police, such are, they are vital powers. They have maintenance of prisons and all these are vital powers, these sovereign powers, government alone should do. But if they cannot be given in contract to any private party, suppose railways, roadways, road constructions, shipping, transport, postal, these are non-sovereign functions, they can be given to private parties. So we are witnessing postal services are privatized by means of couriers. Roadways, road travels are privatized in some by means of giving opportunity to private travelers by maintaining Volvo buses and sleepers and like this. So some commercial activities can be given to private parties, but they are non-sovereign powers. If it is a non-sovereign power, then government is liable. It is sovereign power, state is not liable. There are so many issues which we'll discuss there. I forgot to tell one point, master servant, when master is liable, when master is not liable. Winfield, Professor Winfield, an eminent authority on law of torts, said that a master to be held liable for tort committed by servant, three conditions are to be complete. Three conditions are to be satisfied. Number one, the tort must have been committed by the servant. The tort must have been committed by the servant. Suppose as a master, I am liable for tort committed by servant. The tort committed by another person commits tort, I am not responsible. It should be committed by my servant only. That is first thing. Second, the tort is committed in discharge of his duty or obligations imposed on him by law. Suppose I gave him... I gave him timings from 10 to 5 o'clock to drive my vehicle, and in that period he commits any tort, I will be held liable in discharge of a duty or obligation imposed on him by law. Now, suppose after 5 o'clock night time he will take for extra money, he engages himself in driving some other vehicle and commits tort, I will not be responsible. So that is in discharge of within the course of employment. Third is incidental acts. Incidental acts means certain acts are incidental. Suppose while taking food, taking water in the middle. Yeah, that is incidental. That is incidental. While traveling a journey for 500 kilometers or 1000 kilometers, on the way to stop the vehicle for breakfast or lunch, it is incidental. Also while running long journey to take night halt at some place, it is incidental. So, master is held liable for the torts committed by the servant, provided three conditions are satisfied. Number one, the tort is committed by servant. The tort must be committed in discharge of his duties, in while discharging his duty. Third one is the incidental acts. So, in discharge of duty can be explained in with reference to two things. The discharge of duty, authorized acts and natural consequences. Unauthorized mode of doing, authorized acts. So, first of all, the tort should be committed by the servant. Okay, servant. Second, it is in discharge in doing the work allotted to him. That is second thing. Third one is incidental acts. First and three, there is no problem. In discharging duties, what type of duties he was discharging to begin with? Whether the duties discharged by servant were authorized or not authorized. So, authorized acts and natural consequences, unauthorized mode of doing authorized acts. Suppose, if I am the master, I have a lorry driver, I told him to do certain act, he has done that work, accordingly tort is committed. I am liable. Then, this is authorized mode of doing. I authorized some work, he has completed that work according to my direction only, that is authorized mode of doing. So, unauthorized mode of doing. Suppose I tell my driver, don't go over speed, don't go beyond 80 km speed, don't overtake the vehicles, don't give steering to conductor, don't give steering to cleaner, don't allow unknown passengers, don't make money by entry allowing passengers to travel, like that. Negligent, so don't give steering wheel to your cleaner or some any passenger that joins you. So I tell, don't overtake. So many. You don't do it. But he has done it. I gave some prohibition. I strictly prohibit. Don't do it. But still. He violates my directions and commits. So I cannot say that I told you not to give, not to overtake. Why did you overtake and committed accident? I told you not to go beyond 80 km speed. Why did you go beyond 100 km? I cannot say. Even though I authorized some work, authorized to do the work in some way, but he misused it. He has attended that work in unauthorized way. Still, it comes within the meaning of employment, and a master should be held liable. This topic in detail we will explain in separate chapter. So, vicarious liability means master, one person commits tort and other person is put to liability. That liability is called vicarious liability. Example, master and servant, employment, employer and independent contractor, firm and partners, principal and agent, arresters. This is converted to facit per alien, facit per si, respondent subsidiary. He who does an act to another, deemed in non-law, do it himself. If I enter somebody to do my work, if he commits any wrong, it is deemed that I have committed that wrong, I should be answerable to that wrong thought. That is the issue. And respondent superior. In a wrong, in a tort, one is stronger, other is weaker. You put liability on stronger, that is rich man, so that the aggrieved will get the benefit. If you put the liability on a strong, weaker fellow, poor fellow, he aggrieved cannot get any relief. These are the things. This is with reference to private service. This is one chapter. And another chapter is government servant. Government master's liability. Suppose the sovereign and non-sovereign. So, the tort is committed by servant is okay, in discharge of say is okay. Now, the third point is sovereign or non-sovereign. The discharge of duty is sovereign, government is not liable. Discharge of duty under non-sovereign delegation, government is liable. What is sovereign, what is non-sovereign, there is no any clarity. This was coined for the first time in 1860 in Peninsular and Oriental Steam Navigation versus Secretary of State for India. Chief Justice Peacock coined that this is sovereign, that is non-sovereign. Even then, there is no any clarity. For this sovereign, non-sovereign dichotomy is interpreted by court in different way and protecting the financial interest, economic interest of the state. In so many cases, the relief is denied. In one Vijayavati's case, Vijayavati State of Rajasthan, Chief Justice Sinha said, in that particular case, Vijayavati's husband died of being knocked by collector's jeep on official trip. When the widow approached the court, Rajasthan High Court said that they followed sovereign non-sovereign dichotomy, that collector jeep on official camp comes within the purview of sovereign, and compensation to widow was denied. When this matter went up to Supreme Court headed by Chief Justice Sinha, S.M. Sinha, Sinha said, "What is this nonsense? When an accident is committed, the widow lost her husband. She doesn't have any means of livelihood. She is approaching the court for compensation. While the widow approaching the court for compensation, it is not good to interpret what is sovereign, what is non-sovereign, all. And without referring anything, non-sovereign, sovereign, non-sovereign dichotomy, he gave direction to the Rajasthan government to pay compensation. So even then, there are so many cases. Tulsi Ram case is there, Kasturi Lal case is there, so many cases are there. Kasturi Lal was state of Rajasthan case is there, Tulsi Ram case, so many cases are there. But still the sovereign, non-sovereign dichotomy we are following. There is no any clarity about government liability. The bill to that effect was presented before Lok Sabha long back, 1971-1969, and it was about to pass in 1971, but nearly 50 years elapsed, more than 50 years, that 30 years plus 18 years, 48 years, nearly 50 years elapsed, that government reliability bill has not yet come into force. But this uncertainty, this silence and inordinate delay is to protect the interest of the government, so to get exemption from the liability, to enjoy sovereign immunity. So this is another chapter, that is brief. In detail, we will explain in detail the what are the most important chapter. I will explain each and every point. Vicarious liability of master and servant we discuss. Vicarious liability of state we have given. Next chapter for discussion is remoteness of damage and nervous shock. What is the next chapter? I will give you an idea about each and every chapter around 5 minutes. What is remoteness of damage? Remoteness of damage means damage means loss. The word damage means loss or injury. Damages means compensation. Don't think that damage and damages singular and plural. The word damage means injury. That injury may be personal injury. Some any injury to leg or head or something. Injury may be personal injury. Or reputation injury. Reputation means to your name and fame. Reputation injury. That is defamation. To property injury. It may be movable property or immovable property. Property injury. So that is why injury means, damage means injury. It may be financial injury. It's money injury. Property injury. Damages means compensation. So remoteness of damages. So when a tort is committed, X committed a tort, thereby Y is injured. So X committed a tort, Y is injured. So the injury, when Y wants to file a case against X for tortious liability, the injury must be proximate. Injury must be proximate. Proximate does mean the injury should be as per our expectation, as per our forcibility. That is what is called. Suppose X beats Y with a stick. This much injury. X beats Z with some strong stick. The injury will be something more. Suppose X beats Y with iron rod. The injury will be something more. Suppose X beats Y with a big iron rod on head, so that it resulted in a grievous hurt or culpable homicide or even murder. So that is why the injury is proximate, the wrongdoer is liable. If injury is remote, the injury, the aggrieved should not be made liable. So remoteness of damage means there are certain circumstances, the consequences of a tort are remote or too remote. For example, a cyclist is cycling on the, is going on the road. Some pedestrian while crossing came across the cycle, and the cyclist dashed the pedestrian. That pedestrian fell down. And beside that road, there was a four-wheeler, four cycle, four cycle vehicle where some boiling oil is there for dishes, snacks, for preparation of snacks. It is quite obvious that evening time some snack shops are very very frequent on the roads. Evening they take some snacks which are being boiled in the snack. So having been hit by the cycle, this pedestrian fell on that four-tricycle tricycle where there was a boiling oil. This boiling oil fell and his face is totally destroyed. And it may result in some death also. Now the question is, when one person dashes another with cycle, the injury will be slight something. Suppose when one person dashes somebody, he fell on boiling oil, that boiling oil killed him or injured him very seriously. This shows that the injury is called remote or too remote. This innocent cyclist should not be put to the liability of grievous hurt or culpable homicide or murder. He should be put to liability to the extent of negligent cycling only. This is what this chapter tells. So for this purpose, there are two tests are there. One is the test of directness, then the second one is test of forcibility. So this test of directness tells that compensation, the aggrieved party should be paid for all the consequences he faced. Suppose being hit by cyclist, the pedestrian died. So the cyclist should be put to liability for all the consequences and he should be asked to pay. That is what is called a test of directness. Test of directness means where a tort is committed, even though the consequences are too remote, too severe, for all the serious and severe consequences, the defendant should be held liable. That is, Re-Polymer's case is relevant case on this point. This chapter I will explain in detail in the letter. And next one is the test of forcibility. Test of forcibility means as per expectation only. Suppose as force, force means we expect, we can determine what is the extent of consequences. We can foresee, we can expect, we can have an idea. If one is beaten with a stick, what would be the extent of injury? If one is beaten with iron rod, what would be the extent of injury? If one is beaten with iron rod or hell on head, what would be the extent of injury? That is what is called test of forcibility. For this test of forcibility, there are two cases. One is wagon mount case. Wagon mount case 1, wagon mount case 2 are there. Overseas Tankship UK Limited. There is the case. Overseas Tankship UK Limited. And this is a ship dockyard, falling off iron rod and oil filling case. This is this topic in detail. I will take up in the independent, when I take up this chapter independently. This is force, remoteness of damage means when a tort is committed, injury follows. The injury, it causes injury or damage to another person or group of persons. If the injury injury produces series of consequences, injury to injury, the cyclist dashes pedestrian, he fell on a motorcyclist fell, that man fell on and boiling oil, that man fell, that boiling oil fell down, and all the persons who were eating the food also were damaged. These are all series of consequences. Then we call it as remoteness of the consequences called too remote. This is, if directness is to be followed, the innocent cyclist should be put to liability of all the consequences. Then the forcibility. Now the test of forcibility is a good law. This test of forcibility is to be followed. Test of directness should not be followed. Remoteness of damages, payment of damages which are too remote is absurd. It is not justified. There is no any justification in law. So this is what is called remoteness of chapter. We will study test of directness, test of forcibility, test of directness with reference to Re-Polymer's case, the test of forcibility with reference to wagon mount case number 1, wagon mount, and then next chapter is next remoteness of occupier's liability. occupier's liability is another chapter. In occupier's liability, in the sense, you know, what is the liability of the occupier? There are some shopping complexes, there are some overhead tankers, some people go to visit them, and the strangers, they will mishandle it. Suppose shopping complexes are there. In shopping complexes, there are so many objects one may handle, and one may handle, some problems may take place. So occupier's liability means when you are maintaining a big shopping complex, when you are maintaining some reservoir, when you are maintaining some amusement park, you know, in particularly in summer there will be a park in that there are so many instruments for playing to play the children, and in that process those machinery should be in proper condition. If anything goes wrong, he must be liable. Suppose the person is maintaining a restaurant. In that restaurant, the ceiling fans is there. One ceiling fan is producing rattling noise. There is a doubt that at any time it may fall and cause injury to this. So then, if anything goes wrong, it ought to take place. Any loss or injury takes place causing damage to some victim or aggrieved party, that person can file a case against the owner of that complex. So that owner is who is called occupier. That his liability in tort is called occupier's liability. So this occupier's liability can be explained with three heads. Number one is customers. Outraged customer. Number two, trespassers. Number customers are outraged entrants. Number two is trespassers. Number three, children. Suppose we are having some shopping mall or something. Some people originally enter into that for purchasing. Some people enter the shopping mall to enjoy or to do some mischievous acts. So such those who come to enter without any, shopping mall is there, it is open to public, everybody is treated as invitee, nobody is treated as trespasser. But there are certain things, when some ticket is there, they should purchase ticket and enter it, the trespass to land is legalized by purchasing ticket, which is called license. Suppose some students, mischievous boys, team or girls, they for doing some mischievous things in the land inside without taking ticket, they enter, they are called trespassers. Trespassers means who has exceeded the limit unlawfully, that is called a trespasser. There are some private roads, for example. In that private roads, it is a private road, there is a board. But still, that road is a shortcut road. That is a shortcut road. Shortcut road means shortcut road. If that is private, if any vehicle enters into that for sure to enjoy, to save the time, that is called a trespass or a trespasser. For example, in a city, there is a army premises are there. Army land is there. Army places, there are hundreds of acres of land is there in the middle of the city, like Pune, Bengaluru and those places. And they are out of courtesy. The military authorities are allowing the outside vehicles to pass through the military camp. But actually, because the government, military authorities are providing facility, that is the permission given by the military authorities called a license. Otherwise, the wrongful entry, the trespassers entry became legalized by license. By license means the authorities gave permission, that is license. So license is a thing which legalizes an illegal act. That is, suppose we should not enter into theater without any ticket. That ticket is license. When you purchase the ticket, with the ticket you can enter. So your entry into land is legalized. There is no any trespass to land. Like that we have to discuss about this. This is occupier's liability mean. Then how far the occupier is liable, whether he is a regular customer or invitee or trespasser, but particularly when in the premises children enter, so much care should be taken. There should be so many dangerous objects. But youngsters, elderly people will be able to handle them carefully. Children don't know. But those dangerous objects must be kept beyond the reach of the children. Suppose if the children, they don't know anything, if they handle it, and if anything goes wrong, for which the occupier will have to face the responsibility. So this is the chapter we discuss about occupier's liability. Next, liability for dangerous chattels. Liability for dangerous chattels in the sense, you know, suppose this is with reference to movable property. Then we are supplying some items, some fireworks. Suppose sending rice or wheat is different. Sending explosives, sending pesticides, dispatching pesticides, dispatching dangerous products. So business is allowed for even if there is a license also. If there is a license, with license, revolvers can be manufactured and they can be dispatched. So when you dispatch through some carriers or anything, so when ordinary products, rice, wheat, dolls, there is no any difficulty. You know, just normal packing, you can say. When you send some dangerous material like pesticides, dangerous products, and they you must be very careful. Some products are basically, they are dangerous. Some are basically not dangerous. Suppose hot water bottle. Hot water bottle is not dangerous because some hot water is poured into that bottle and it is applied. Suppose if the water bag is not manufactured with proper material, while applying this water bottle, water bag, filling the water, it may burst, and the heavy water, too hot water, may cause damage, and serious damage to skin, and that is for which the manufacturer of the water bottle should be held liable. So when some products, movable things are there, they are transferred from one place to another. Some are dangerous by nature, some are not dangerous. But whether they are dangerous or not, every care should be taken. If it is not taken, the person who has dispatched the material, the real owner of that will have liability. The duty towards person to whomsoever he sends, the customers, whoever may be the customer. The customer may be within the town, within the district, within the state, within the country, outside the country. Whomsoever may be the customer, he will be his neighbor. He owes duty of care. If proper care is not taken, the person of dangerous chattels is to be held liable. So this is about this thing. Next one is liability for, next chapter for discussion is liability for animals. Liability for animals. So we say that we have, suppose our cow, the way we cows, we have cows, buffaloes, dogs, in some cases the camels, horses, zebras, some people maintain a tiger, in zoos they maintain tigers, circus company people maintain tigers, lions, and lions, elephants, etc. So when to constitute crime, the wrongdoer must be human being, the aggrieved must be human being. If man kills man, it is crime. Man commits rape to woman, it is crime. Man commits theft or robbery or dacoity, it is crime. So the wrongdoer is a human being, the aggrieved party is a human being. If wrongdoer and aggrieved party both are human being, it is crime. Sometimes what happens is the wrongdoer is animal, aggrieved party is human being. In such case, it is not crime. It is a tort. It is a civil liability. Who will have to face the civil liability? The owner of the animal should face the civil liability. So this is what is called animal trespass. So then this subject, animals liability, is studied under a heading Scienter rule. Scienter rule. What the scienter rule means? Liability. Knowledge has to veracity. Now, scienter means knowledge has to veracity of dangerous nature of the animal is called scienter. We know this is categorized into two heads. Fera nature and mensuta nature. Fera nature means the animal dangerous by itself. Mensuta nature means an animal not dangerous by itself. We know tiger, lion, elephant, zebra, bear, and certain animals or monkeys, including monkeys. They are dangerous animals by nature. Mensuta nature means they are not dangerous by nature. Cow, ox, bull, or any gentle beast, camel, horse, these are non-dangerous animals. So, whether it is dangerous animal causes injury, non-dangerous animal causes injury, the owner of the animal should be held liable. So, if it is a dangerous animal, the scienter need not be proved. If it is non-dangerous animal, the scienter should be proved. For example, dog comes within the meaning of non-dangerous animal. So, many people maintain dogs, but those dogs do not do anything. Some dogs, they can move in public. So, they do not cause any injury. They do not bite. But sometimes the owner knows that the dog is of vicious nature. Then he must keep it in a very careful place and see that anybody passing through that way should not be bitten. So similarly, cow, normally good one, gentle one. Buffalo, gentle one. But there are some cows may be injurious. Some buffaloes, bulls may be inferior, dangerous. When the owner of the animal is having the knowledge about the vicious nature, ferocity of that animal, he must keep it at his own peril. If anything goes wrong, and he must be held liable. So similarly, our cattle, cows, buffaloes enter into the land of somebody and have nibbled the crop, ready crop. Then what extent that loss is there, that loss is to be paid by the owner of the animals. That occupier of that land, whose crop is nibbled by the animal, can keep them at his custody by providing necessary water and everything. And the owner of the animal should pay necessary loss and take back the animal. So, these are the various things. This topic we will discuss in detail. Now, the purpose of this chapter is to let you know what that chapter will explain you. So, the scienter rule will speak about this liability for animals. Next chapter for discussion is trespass. Trespass to person, trespass to land, trespass to immovable property, trespass to movable property. Now, trespass means to exceed the limits. Trespass, passing beyond the limit. Trespass means to pass beyond the limit. That is called trespass. Now, this trespass is there with reference to person. Trespass is there with reference to land or immovable property. Trespass is there with reference to movable property also. That is what is called trespass. Suppose this area, this 1 acre land is mine. My neighbor has 1 acre land. So I must use my land only. I should not make use of my neighbor's land. Then it amounts to trespass to land. Now, before property, going to movable property, immovable property, we should speak about trespass to person. This trespass to person, the law starts impose duty on a person to do not certain things, not to do certain things. That duty is imposed on him by law. Suppose suppose I can enjoy the freedom of speech, Article 19 1A, I can speak anything of my choice. But my tongue must not exceed. My tongue must not exceed. I should not speak nonsense about politician. He is a smuggler, he is a gambler, he every time he gets elected by rigging, all that nonsense I should not speak. So I should not speak bad about a woman. She is not a characterless, she moves with so many boyfriends like that, I should not say. I should not speak nonsense about a man. That is, I should not create any fear among before another, inflict any fear in the boy, in the mind of another. I will kill you, I will beat you, like that. So this trespass to person is three categories. Number one, assault. Number two, battery. In criminal law, it is called criminal force. Number three, false imprisonment. False imprisonment is old term. Wrongful confinement is present term. So the trespass to person is three categories. One is assault. Second one is battery. In torts, it is called battery. In criminal law, it is called criminal force. Wrongful confinement. Assault, battery, wrongful confinement, three are torts. These three are felonious torts. There is a tortious liability is there, criminal liability is there. If I commit assault, I will have civil liability and criminal liability. If I commit battery, I will have civil liability and criminal liability. So mayhem is one point. Mayhem, that is serious. Mayhem is like hurt. Battery is equal to hurt. Mayhem is equal to grievous hurt. So in criminal law, there is a degree of error, degrees of seriousness. Suppose assault. What nonsense you are doing? I will kill you. I will break your head out like that. In a shivering, shaking, I create, inflict some pain in your mind. That is called assault. I am not supposed to do like this. So that other party, the aggrieved party, can file a case against me in criminal law for assault and in tort law, in civil court for compensation also. That is assault. Battery. Battery means just without touching body, I am inflicting, I am creating fear in the mind of other person as well as to show some threat against him. That is assault. Suppose I touch the body, some injury is caused to him. That amounts to battery. For civil liability is there. In criminal law, it is called hurt. Hurt means some injury is there. Some wounds are there. Some little blood also may come. So that is hurt. Now, grievous hurt. Grievous hurt means, grievous hurt is in criminal law. Mayhem, it is called mayhem in tort law. Grievous hurt means loss of disfigurement, loss of nose, loss of ear, loss of hand, loss of both hand, loss of leg. And if the injury is too serious, it is called mayhem. It is called mayhem, grievous hurt. So, criminal law, I told you last time, assault, if the assault means creating some fear to beat and to cause some harm, that is assault. Serious form of assault is battery. It is a threat to create harm. Cause harm is assault. Causing some little harm by touching the body, so by beating, by slash stabbing, that is hurt. Serious form of hurt is grievous hurt. Taking some strong weapon and breaking his hand or breaking his leg or breaking his eye like that. That is grievous hurt. Yes. Serious, more serious hurt will become serious grievous hurt. The serious, more serious grievous hurt will constitute culpable homicide. Grievous hurt will constitute culpable homicide. Serious culpable homicide will amount to murder. These are the various degrees of inflection of volume, the quantum of injury. As per the increase in volume of injury caused to the aggrieved party, then it begins from assault, criminal force, battery in tort, next hurt in criminal law, battery in civil law or criminal force, and then grievous hurt, mayhem in tort, culpable homicide, murder, they are only pure crimes. They are not both torts and crimes. Torts and crimes. Assault, battery, wrongful confinement. So what is assault, battery? We have to discuss. What is mayhem? Serious disfigurement. That is there. Next one is wrongful confinement. Fourth type of tort is wrongful. These are all specific torts. Wrongful confinement, olden days it was called false imprisonment. False imprisonment, unnecessarily imprisoning. Wrongful confinement, now the modern word is wrongful confinement. Wrongful confinement, section 352, 60, so many sections are there provided for under criminal law. There are various degrees. Suppose wrongful confinement doesn't mean arresting a man and putting in prison. Suppose a person is detained on highway even for half an hour, it amounts to wrongful confinement. A case to that effect can be filed. Suppose there is a public way, everybody is having right to pass through that way. If somebody organizing some function and blocked the road, or some person, a businessman, to loading and unloading, loading process, the lorry is stopped in the middle and all the vehicles are getting diverted and going through another way without questioning. But even keeping lorry, parking lorry for unloading purpose or loading purpose in a public way for considerable length of time amounts to wrongful confinement, and a case can be instituted. Civil and criminal case can be instituted against him. But we people are having an adjusting mentality. We cooperate the people for any function purpose, road is blocked, for any loading unloading of business purpose, the blah, road is blocked, wrongful confinement. We don't go for cases because we people of India are very good people. We are very liberal. We don't like to go to court. But one way we are good people, one way we are very fearful people, because even if we go to court, we are doubtful that it will take many years to get the relief, because in view of pendency of cases and inordinate delay in disposal of cases due to several reasons, that is the position. But in UK, US and other advanced countries, this situation is not like this. They will take it very serious. For simple reason also, they approach the courts and get the relief. So this is about trespass to land. Similarly, trespass to land, trespass to immovable land or immovable property, and next one is trespass to movable property. This difference is just simple difference. The concepts are same. Trespass to land. Trespass to land means this is my 1 acre land. My side neighbor is 1 acre land. Suppose while cutting the crop, I should not keep the crop on my neighbor's land. No, then it amounts to trespass to land. So if my neighbor gives permission, that is called permission, license. Then with the consent or with the permission of my neighbor, I can keep the cutting crop on his land and make use of his. But he objects it. If he files a complaint, I will be held liable for civil and criminal. I will have civil and criminal liability. That is a trespass to land. So sometimes there are important topic there. Trespass ab initio. The item is common for both and trespass ab initio. What do you mean by trespass ab initio? So misuse of legal authority or lawful authority. When legal or lawful authority is misused to get an entry into a premises, the original entry itself is illegal. For example, the police officer has an arrest warrant to arrest an individual. Now, it is the duty of the police officer has a license to enter into the premises or to have some search warrant. Suppose some valuable information, valuable product, process to compel production of things is there. In CRPC you will study. And suppose an object which is useful for to present before the court is there in a person. Then the police officer, whether he wants to arrest the person or to search something, he should, for what purpose he is authorized to enter into the premises, he should do it. After entering into that, if he commits any misuse, his original entry will be declared invalid. That is what is called trespass ab initio. This is with reference to trespass to immovable property or land, trespass to movable property. The topics are almost identical. In this, some important topic is there, trespass ab initio. That is, suppose trespass, we are not supposed to enter into somebody's land. If we enter into somebody's land without any permission or without any consent of the landlord, it amounts to trespass to land. But if the landlord gives permission, that permission is called license. We can, with the help of that license, we can enter it. Then it is not trespass. For example, the police officer asked to go and arrest an accused on charges of some crime. Then the police officer will have some search warrant to search some things to be produced before the court. Then the police officer's purpose is he should enter into, with the permission given by the court, that is license, he enters into that house. It is not a trespass. But he is supposed to either to arrest the person or to search some things. He should do the particular job with for what purpose he is given license to go and enter into the premises. He should do it. But after entering into that, he misbehaves with the person. Any lady inmate, or if he searches unnecessary things which are confidential documents of the person to be arrested, but after entering into that, he has committed an act of misfeasance, that is called mischievous act. Then if he does so, his original entry itself is unlawful. So then the police officer is liable as if he has entered into the land without any permission or license. So this is the trespass to land. You can study in immovable property and movable property also. And there is a relevant point is there on Six Carpenters case is there. So these topics, if time permits, we will discuss all these things in extra. So the purpose is to give some what is what. And next topic for discussion is defamation. Defamation means money, movable, immovable properties are tangible properties. The properties we can see. Our name, fame, reputation is intangible property. This property we cannot see. So, if loss is caused to our person, we can file a case for tort. If we suffer any loss or damage, we can file a case for assault, battery or mayhem or wrongful confinement. Suppose if any loss or damage caused to our property, immovable property or movable property, we can. Our person, movable property, immovable property, these injuries, any loss or damage caused, they are tangible, they can be seen. But our property cannot be seen. My reputation, my name is intangible property. My name as other, my name as other, or it is intangible property, intellectual property. So sometimes what happens is, wrong suffered. See, if any one person commits any tort causing injury or damage to reputation of another person, it is called defamation. Defamation is a tort. It is a statement. Defamation is a statement, oral or in writing, in estimation of right-thinking members of the society, causes injury or damage to reputation of another. That is called defamation. So, suppose in estimation of right-thinking members, and what are good statements, what are bad statements, we know. So, that politician is a great man, he is doing harm and service to the people of conscience. That is good statement. Everybody will say that. It is a good statement. That politician is not a good man. He gets elected every time by rigging. But he eats all the money granted to the conscience. He doesn't take care of public welfare. Such statements are bad. In estimation of right-thinking members of society, in the sense, what statements are good, what statements are not good, what are good statements, what are bad statements, we can understand. But this is what is called defamation. Suppose if such wrong statements are made, false statements are, it is a publication of a false statement. Defamation is publication of a false statement. False statement means untrue statement. Untrue statement. In estimation of right-thinking members of society, which cause injury or damage to the reputation or character of another person. There is a very, very good woman. She is a very good woman. But that woman is a prostitute. If any such statement is made, it is a very dangerous. This is a defamatory statement. That is defamatory statement. Now, this defamation can be done. The defamation is of two kinds. One is libel and other is slander. Libel means defaming by means of written publication. Suppose the publisher made a statement published in his newspaper about government, bad about functioning of judiciary. So they are very serious statements, very serious and dangerous statement. It is a libel. Libel is a tort as well as a crime. The person who made a libel statement will have to pay compensation under tortious liability. He will be undergoing prison. So libel, slander. Next, slander. Libel is action pulpercy. What is the harm caused need not be proved. The plaintiff, while filing a case for libel against the defendant, the court will not ask what is the loss you suffered, because when the matter is such serious, it is published in newspaper, the what extent he suffered loss, is a reputed MLA, reputed politician, MLA, MP or minister, on him a paper statement came, and paper statement came defaming his conduct and character. There is no need to prove that what extent of loss he has suffered. That is a libel. So it is a libel. The libelous form of defamation is action pulpercy. Means it itself is actionable. So the defendant, the plaintiff, need not prove what loss he has suffered. So slander. Slander is a oral statement. Oral or verbal statement. Oral or verbal statement. So say, because by words of mouth, that politician is not good, that businessman is not good, he is a smuggler, like that. This is oral words. Oral words means not powerful than like written words. Suppose we had a news that somebody is arrested. If we see that in newspaper or radio or TV, we can certainly believe. Because somebody said, immediately we will telephone to our friend near or dear, I heard that so and so is arrested. Is it correct? I heard that so and so is assassinated. Is it correct? Hearsay, we cannot believe so easily. So libel is more serious. That is why it is actionable per se. The defendant, the plaintiff need not prove the loss suffered. Such slander is not actionable per se. So when a slanderous defamation statement is there, the aggrieved party should prove that the defendant made a slander. I suffered this much loss, he has to do. But the slander also, there are some exceptions. What are the exceptions? For example, suppose a woman, an unchastity is imputed on a woman. Mr. So-and-so, working in so-and-so office, she is a prostitute. She every day, she moves with one boyfriend today, moves with another boyfriend tomorrow, like that false statement is made. So, it is, though it is oral, it is not published in writing, then that woman has a cause of action to file a case. When she files a case for a defamation, slander, she need not prove any damages, because even though it is slander, it is equal to libel, more serious than libel. So she need not prove any damages. Suppose another thing, if any slanderous statement, oral statement is made affecting the name, fame or reputation of reputation. Suppose doctor, are you going to the doctor? If you go to doctor, will not come back. Don't go to the doctor, he is important. Or some businessman, if you purchase any material in that shop, it cannot be useful for consumption. So if any oral statement is made affecting the trade or profession of anybody, competence of anybody with reference to talent and knowledge, that also is though it is slander, it is actionable per se. Plaintiff need not prove the loss suffered. So these are what is defamation, what are the elements of defamation, what are the kinds of defamation, what are the defenses of defamation, we have to study. Defamation kinds. It must be defamatory, it must refer to the plaintiff, it must be published. These three conditions I will explain in detail. Label two kinds. Label, defamation is two kinds. One is label, other is slander. These two things we will discuss in a separate chapter. There are defenses. There are three defenses available to the privilege. Number one, available to the defendant to get exemption from the liability. Number one is truth. ட்ரூத், ட்ரூத் நம்பர் ஒன் ட்ரூத், செகண்ட் ஒன் இது ஃபெயர் காமெண்ட், தேர்ட் ஒன் இது ப்ரிவிலேஜ். ப்ரிவிலேஜ் தேர் ஆர் டூ, அப்சல்யூட் ப்ரிவிலேஜ், குவாலிஃபைடு ப்ரிவிலேஜ். ஆல் தீஸ் ஆஸ்பெக்ட்ஸ் ஐ வில் டேக் அப் இன் அ செப்பரேட் லெக்சர். இது நோ தி பர்பஸ் ஆஃப் திஸ் லெக்சர் இஸ் டு கிவ் டென்டேட்டிவ் ஐடியா அபவுட் தி chapter. Now the next after defamation, next chapter is nuisance and causing injury or physical discomfort. Nuisance, what is this nuisance? We say that suppose in our village, in our locality, somebody is maintaining pigs, somebody is maintaining some poultry farm, producing foul smell like this. Somebody is maintaining lot of buffalo and all. It is creating lot of nuisance. So that is what is called nuisance. Nuisance is, what is the nuisance, what is the meaning? Causing annoyance and physical discomfort, infliction of injury or causing annoyance or physical discomfort by act or omission is nuisance. This nuisance is two kinds. One is private nuisance, other is public nuisance. Private nuisance means private nuisance is tort, public nuisance is tort and crime. Public nuisance is tort and crime. Private nuisance, for I give you some practical example. Suppose I am residing in one portion, my neighbor is in side portion, and the drainage from my house should not goes towards neighbor. It is private nuisance because my drainage is going towards my neighbor and causing inconvenience, physical discomfort and foul smell. Then my neighbor alone is facing the problem. That is a private nuisance. He alone can file a case against me. He alone can file a case against me. It is tortious liability. Suppose the drainage from my house extended towards road is in front of my home and causing a lot of the entire road in front of my house became slippery. So many people are going, some are getting their it is slippery, some fell down, some are injured. So public at large are facing problem. That is called public nuisance. In private nuisance is only tort. It is for which the relief is abatement of nuisance, payment of compensation or removal of nuisance like this. And public nuisance, it is a crime. It is a crime as well as tort. So the private nuisance, the aggrieved alone can file a case. But in public nuisance, all cannot, everybody who is going on the road should not, cannot file a case. But the attorney general or the collector of that person, any case is instituted through some appropriate authority, case should be filed. So if any public member of the public facing inconvenience because of this public nuisance, he has to lodge a complaint with the police officer or may commute it through the police officer, and the matter goes to the collector, and collector will take appropriate action for abatement or removal of the nuisance. So what are these kinds? What is private nuisance? What is public nuisance? What are the Hollywood silver fox is the best case, leading case in this point. All these aspects we study in nuisance. Next chapter is negligence. Negligence is a very big chapter. It is a very lengthy chapter, and there will be a question. It covers so many things. Negligence means breach of duty to take care. Breach of duty to take care which the defendant owes towards the plaintiff. Breach of duty to take care which the defendant owes towards the plaintiff. Breach of duty. Suppose breach of duty. Breach of duty means failure to perform duty. Owes means having towards the plaintiff. Suppose when I drive the vehicle, I owe duty of care towards all the road users, bystanders, opposite vehicles, following vehicles. They are my neighbors. I have duty. And when I drive motorcycle, I owe duty of care towards the all road users. I should not dash them. Suppose I am supplying milk. I am supplying milk. So the milk should be in consumable condition. they should, it should not be contaminated. So if I supply milk within the town, all consumers in the town are my neighbor, I owe duty towards all the consumers within the town. Suppose I supply the milk to entire district, all consumers in the district, I owe duty of care towards all the consumers in the district. If anybody in within the district suffers any loss due to contaminated milk, I should be held liable. Suppose I produce wines and supply the wines to whole state and whole country or even outside country, every consumer, whether within the country or within the state or outside the state, where they are supplied, will be my neighbor. I owe duty of care towards them. So if whatever duty of care defendant owes towards plaintiff must be strictly adhered to. If the duty is breached, that amounts to breach of duty, it results in negligence. So this negligence is a two-in-one thought. This negligence, sometimes in law of torts can be discussed into, they are split into two parts. First part is the principles, second part is the specific. Assault, battery, mayhem, wrongful confinement, strict liability, defamation, trespass to land, trespass to mobile property. These are specific torts. Now the question is negligence. Negligence, sometimes it can be used as a principle, sometimes it can be used as a specific tort. A specific tort. Just like criminal conspiracy in criminal law. In criminal law, Indian Penal Code contains 511 sections. Section 1 to 120 deal with, these sections deal with principles and defenses. Principles and defenses. 120A deals with defines criminal conspiracy. 120B prescribes punishment for criminal conspiracy. 121 to 511, all the sections deal with specific offenses. This criminal conspiracy, for criminal conspiracy itself, case can be filed. Then it is called a specific offense. For case is filed only for criminal conspiracy, that is specific. For murder, to prove some murder or rape, kidnapping, abduction, or any item, the criminal conspiracy in that particular crime, criminal conspiracy is there. Then theft, for committing theft, if the door is locked, property is taken away, that is theft. So the people are there in the home, knocking the door, threatening at a pistol or knife and taking, it is robbery. Like that, extortion, inflicting some pain by the police officer, inflicting some pain in the person in custody. Unless you bring money, I will do this, that. By creating fear and money taking, it is extortion. Like this. So, for committing a specific crime, criminal conspiracy is there. For in order to prove that crime, the criminal conspiracy should be proved first. So, then that case, criminal conspiracy is not only a principle. Sometimes it is applied as a principle, sometimes it is used as an instrument to prove some specific offense. Like that, the negligence also, in order to prove some specific tort, negligence is necessary. For defamation, for example, the publisher made a defamatory statement about some politician. So without taking, when he received some defamatory statement about some leading person, he must check and take all necessary care whether the defamatory statement given to me for publication by so and so person, whether the defamatory statement is true or not, whether some politician is arrested or not, whether it is a right or not, he must check very carefully and sign it. So after making a proper investigation and check and verification with necessary genuine rights, genuine reasons, if the information is genuine, if the information is correct, genuine, and it is, if it is published, it will be useful to the public, and if it is true and it is for public, and he should publish it, then he is not liable for defamation. So negligence, sometimes for negligence itself case can be filed, sometimes to prove some specific tort, negligence can be used as an instrument. So now, So the negligence for first time was coined by Lord Anderson in Black vs. Birmingham Waterworks Company Limited. All the details of negligence we will see. In negligence, we study what is negligence, what is meaning, what are the elements of negligence. So one is the negligence, in this case, Donegal vs. Stevenson case will become the principle of the principle of neighborhood will come. Under this, the test of forcibility will take place. If the negligence, if you are negligent, it is harmful, then the test of forcibility. If the injury is forcible, the defendant is liable. If the injury is not forcible, the defendant is not liable. Rural, so many cases are there. So, the plaintiff, what elements mean, the plaintiff must, defendant should show, prove that, the defendant, the plaintiff must prove that, the defendant owes duty of care towards the plaintiff. The defendant should say, the plaintiff should say, he is expected to take care towards me, that should be proved. Second thing, he breached the two, he breached the duty. That man has to take care of me, but he did not take care. That is breach. Breach should be proved. This breach is subject to test of forcibility. If he takes care, injury could not take place. If he did not take care, injury would take place. That is what is called injury. Suppose a man is driving the vehicle, and the bus is overloaded. Some passengers are walking on the, traveling on the top of the bus. Rural transport versus Basilum BB. When the driver should know, the bus is overloaded. Some passengers are traveling on the top. Then he should drive the vehicle very carefully. If any dry trees are there, and there are overhanging branches are there, he must slow it, stop it, and take diversion and trot. So without following anything, he rushes into overhanging branch of the tree, and thereby the persons who were traveling on the top of the bus fell down, having been hit by the branch of the tree. If any injury comes, the test is forcible. So if injury is forcible, actionable. Injury not forcible, not actionable. On this, these are three conditions are there. These things we will discuss very effectively. And they, when plaintiff wants to file a case against defendant, he must prove three conditions. If he proves the condition, then detainment comes to defendant. Then there is one problem. Res ipsa loquitur. Res, the thing tells its own story. So when plaintiff wants to file a case against defendant, he has to prove the essential conditions of negligence. Sometimes the plaintiff need not prove any essential condition, because the thing tells its own story. That is what is called res ipsa loquitur. Suppose you are long living in an apartment, there is the ground floor and the upstairs, only one floor is there. The ground floor, the housewife is moving in the veranda, some heavy object fell on her head. Burn versus bodily is relevant case on this head. So, in the relevant case on this point. So, what happened? Unless somebody negligent, when you drop some object on the ground floor, you should see whether in the ground floor, whether anybody is moving. Then only you should put it down. So, without putting it, suppose a man is asked to climb the tree and cut the coconut. When he climbed the tree and cut the coconut and put down the coconut, he should see whether anybody is moving. Then only, without moving, without seeing anything, after cutting, simply he throws it down. Then somebody in the ground injured. So in that case, the aggrieved party need not prove that the man who climbed the tree is negligent. So the rips ipsa loquitur, the thing tells its own story. Suppose there is a tower clock, it is more than 100 years. If there is any building, it is more than 100 years. His life is 100 years, 150 years elapsed, still it is not demolished. No steps are taken for reconstruction of the building by collapsing it. Then the thing tells its own story. The aggrieved party need not prove any loss or damage. So, like that, next thing is exceptions. There are so many exceptions to get exemption from the liability for tort of negligence. But there is one act of God is there. And the most important thing is contributory negligence. In contributory negligence. Now, contributory negligence means The next defense under negligence is contributory negligence. Contributory negligence is a very important topic. I will explain in detail in negligence after. Contributory negligence is simply mean both aggrieved and there is negligence on the part of aggrieved party and tortfeasor. For example, road crossing. Suppose the vehicle is going in speed. If speeding vehicle, the person has not stopped from crossing. A pedestrian is crossing the road. When he wants to cross the road, he must observe any vehicle is approaching vehicle is there. In spite of witnessing the approaching vehicle, he has crossed the vehicle. He has crossed the road. He attempted to cross the road, but in spite of seeing a man crossing the road, he did not apply braking time. In this case, 50% road crosser is responsible, 50% aggrieved party wrongdoer is driver is responsible. Suppose that man died, a compensation is payable, 10 lakhs compensation is payable, 50% compensation is deducted according to this. Then the second thing is next system is, suppose the aggrieved is 50% responsible, 50% is deducted. We are in the case of Vidyavedi versus Madhya Pradesh Road Transport Corporation. And aggrieved is 75% responsible, only 2,05,000 is paid. If 75% negligence is there on the part of deceased, for 10 lakhs, 7.5 lakhs is deducted, 25 lakhs is paid. Suppose if the aggrieved is deceased is 100% responsible. Suppose the vehicle is parked on the road, a scooterist directly rushed into the back side of the vehicle and crushed into the back part of that vehicle, parked lorry, and died 100%. But in this particular case, the owner of the parking vehicle is 0% negligent, but the deceased is 100% negligent. The relevant case is Oriental Fire and General Insurance Company in such. These cases with facts I will explain in independent chapter, don't worry. But here 100% negligent, no liability. Case was dismissed. So after this 1981, ours is welfare state. A man may die, but what is the position of the next kith and kin? For that purpose, even though the aggrieved party or deceased party is 100% negligent, some compensation should be paid. For that purpose, at the time, Motor Vehicles Act was there, 1939. That Motor Vehicle Act was amended in the year 1982. A new section, Chapter 5A or 6A plus Subsection 92A is added. Under the Section 92A, for no fault liability, the principle of no fault liability is created. According to this principle of no fault liability, even though the aggrieved party or deceased party is 100% negligent, the owner of the vehicle or driver of the vehicle is no way 0% negligent, still some compensation should be paid. At that time, under Section 92A, if a person died, 15,000 was paid. If there is a total disablement, though survived, he would be unfit for work and unfit for making any livelihood, 7,500 was paid. So, the Motor Vehicle Act, after the Amendment Act of 1982, in course of time, it was totally, Motor Vehicles Act 1939 was abolished, repealed, and in that place, Motor Vehicles Act 1988 was passed. Under Section 140 to 144, make provision for so many accident, no fault liability this. So according to that, according to Section 140, for death, if the deceased is 100% negligent, if death take place, 50,000 rupees was paid. If the aggrieved party survived and with permanent total disablement, he will get 25,000 compensation. Now there is also provision for under Section 141 for hit and run cases. Hit and run case, sometimes what happens is on road the driver of the vehicle hits some pedestrian on the road and runs away, because if he stops the vehicle, the surrounding people will come and attack him. to avoid from the liability, he left after hitting the pedestrian or somebody committing accident, he runs away, he ran away. But the police and other officials made all inquiries and investigation, but all the efforts to trace out the wrongdoer, culprit, were in vain. In such a case, if the person met with accident died, the next kith and kin would be paid 25,000, and if survived, 12,500 rupees was paid. For hit and run cases also is there. Some full solution, some fund called solution fund is created to that effect. In this connection, the water of the state government would contribute some 25%, central government would contribute some 25%, and the concerned insurance company will contribute some 50%. Like this, it is there. This is the negligence chapter. The negligence chapter is very important from examination point of view. From first point to last point, I will explain this chapter in detail. This is something about the negligence chapter. After negligence, next chapter is nuisance. I completed strict liability. What is strict liability? I explained in my lecture 1 with detail, but it is said that it is not clear some taking, but if you use a earphone, you will be able to understand each and everything very clearly. It is said that it is a lecture, just lecture, you know? It was given in the presence of so many students, recorded it. The presentation they reported to be very good, but you just listen to that. Again, all the topics I will repeat as and when time permits. The strict liability means, is also known as the rule in Rylance versus Fletcher. Rule in Rylance versus Fletcher. In England, judges are vested with law-making power. So, when the case is there, the judges, that if the judges deem fit to coin a new law, to formulate a new law, they can make a new law. So, that new law is created at that particular case. So, that is why the rule in Baker versus Bolton, rule in Meriwether versus Nixon, rule in strict liability. So, these rules are just like law. How Parliament passed a law, the judges also make law, frame law in a particular case. That is, then we call it as, that law is called judgment law. Judgment law, common law means judgment law. In England, law made by judges is called judgment law. Like that, the rule in Lawrence versus Fletcher or strict liability is a common law or judgment law coined for the first time, formulated or expounded for the first time by Justice Blackburn in Rylance versus Fletcher. In this case, particularly till then, up to that 1860, a artificer is liable if there is negligence on that part. Suppose if it is a defamation, trespass, nuisance or anything. If there is a negligence on his part, he is liable. If there is no any negligence on his part, he is not liable. So, whether tortfeasor is liable or not, what will decide? Negligence will decide. Negligence is instrument. So, if negligent on the part of wrongdoer is tortfeasor is present, he is liable. If negligence is not present, he is not liable. So, whether a person to be held liable for tort, negligence is basis. Now, whether there is negligence on the part or not, whether the person is negligent or non-negligent, still he is liable. Such liability is called strict liability. There are some peculiar cases. There are some important cases of great public importance. Whether there is a negligence or not, the defendant is liable. The occupier is liable. Such liability is called strict liability. This type of liability was created for the first time in Rylance versus Fletcher. In this case, details in a separate chapter I'll tell. So in this case, the owner of a reservoir employed a qualified engineer. He did not engage any ordinary man who is not technically qualified. A qualified engineer was appointed as independent contractor for construction of the reservoir, but the workers negligently finished the work. The water got burst and the water flooded towards plaintiff's coal mines, and plaintiff's coal mines were damaged. When plaintiff filed a case against defendant, the defendant was confident. Okay, What is there? If anything goes wrong, master-servant relationship lies between independent contractor and the workers who committed mistake. I am employer, I am not liable, he thought. But in this particular case, Justice Blackburn said that no, up to that negligence is important, but now there is negligence is no bar, then you have to meet the consequences either. So what is on what basis it is made, what are the things, the negligence and strict liability chapter, each and everything, meaning, definition of negligence, what is strict liability, when it was coined, who coined this, what is the content, what on what basis it is coined, what are the elements for to prove strict liability, what are the defenses. So for strict liability, there are 5 defenses. So the defendant can get exemption from liability with the help of 5 defenses. In 5 defenses, namely, plaintiff's own fault, malicious act of stranger, state, common benefit, statutory authority, act of God, like that. There are some 5 defenses. Whether you are negligent, earlier, before Stallings versus Fletcher case, if you are negligent, you are liable for tort. If you are not negligent, you are not liable for tort. From the time, strict liability, whether you are negligent or not, you are liable. That is strict liability. However, you are given some defenses to get exemption from the liability. There are 5 defenses. With those, the negligence, strict liability, those you have known they are not negligent, you are asked to face the liability. Still, you are given an option to get exemption from liability with 5 defenses. 5 defenses are available. If the defenses are removed and you are liable, that liability is absolute liability. The principle of absolute liability was coined in 1986 by then the Chief Justice of India, P.N. Bhagwati, in India, oleum gas leak case. Oleum gas leak case. Sriram Foods and Fertilizers, oleum gas leak case. At that time, I will explain the thing in detail. So, this is the strict liability. What is strict liability? What is the basis for strict liability? What are the elements of strict liability? What are the defenses of strict liability? I will take up in separate chapter. And then after strict liability, next chapter is death in relation to tort. Death in relation to tort. Actio personalis moritor cum persona is a popular maxim. Death in relation to tort. Now the question is, the case is there. A committed tort, B suffered injury. And B filed a case against A. Before the case is decided, if A dies, old law, if A dies, the case is closed. B dies, case is closed. Suppose A committed tort, B suffered injury, B filed a case against A, and B will, if he wins the case, B will get a compensation of some 1 lakh, like that. Now, if A dies, whether B can claim the compensation from legal heirs of A or not, that is the question. Suppose B dies, whether the compensation is payable to legal heirs or not, these are the things. So, it is with reference to this, when there is a case, tortious litigation between two persons, if plaintiff dies, the case is closed, or defendant dies, case is closed. On that, this is the old rule that if A dies, the case is closed, B dies, the case is closed, and the survivors will not enter into the shoes of the deceased. Now, in this liability is under two heads. Death as an extinguishing liability, death as a creating liability. Death as extinguishing liability means when one party dies, the case is closed. The case is closed. The consequences of tort get extinguished. That is creating liability. So even though the death is takes place, his legal right and legal here will come into picture. Suppose we say that a man, a rich man, dies, all the property will be distributed among his natural heirs, wife, children and all. Sometimes there is a case, a man dies with some liability. With liability, suppose some amount is payable to some creditor for some purpose, some 1 lakh or 2 lakhs. That creditor may ask the children, your father... I lent 1 lakh to your father without repayment, with interest, your father died, you pay. Then the children may say, no, in what way we are responsible? My father took loan, you gave money to my father. How can we pay? The children may say. They should not say. Because then that trader, that businessman will say, your father gives you property, we will distribute. You don't share the liability of your father. That is there. So the principle of paisa obligation, doctrine of paisa obligation is there. In our law, in joint family, we will explain about this. Doctrine of paisa obligation, what it tells is, anybody who died without clearing of the debt cannot go to heaven. He will swing between hell and heaven. Suppose there is a man, he is the father of the family. He may be 60 years, 70 years or 80 years. So he has some liability worth of 5 to 10 lakhs. He died. But when he died without repaying the property, without repaying the debt, he cannot go to heaven peacefully. That he swings between hell and heaven. So the so-called putra, putra means 3 degrees in ascending order, 3 degrees in descending order. Father, 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 grandfather, great-grandfather, son, grandson, great-grandson, like that. So whoever dies first, the next man is putra. He has an obligation to do, clear the debt. That obligation is called the doctrine of putra. So, for some rights, putra is accountable. For some rights, putra is not accountable. For example, surety debts and all. Surety debts, betting debts, like this. Like this also, according to the principle of actio personal is moris ter compersna, the death, the case, litigation comes to an end with the litigation gets extinguished. Litigation disappears with the death of the either of the party. There is no any, the case will not be transferred to the liability will not be transferred to the survivor. That is the question. But there are some exceptions. Contracts. There are two exceptions. Contracts, principle of natural justice. Suppose we take it for granted. If party dies, the case is closed. But it is not applicable to two exceptions. Contracts. Contract, principle of natural justice. What is contract? What is principle of natural justice? Suppose, in contract also, for some cases, survivor is responsible. Some cases, survivor is not responsible. Suppose, A and B enter into a contract. A wanted to sell his house for 10 lakhs. B wanted to purchase that. B gave advance of 5 lakhs. And before the contract of sale is executed, A died. Then A has a liability to hand over the house by taking the 5 lakhs. But in the meantime, the rates increased. The 10 lakh house rose to 50 lakhs. But who is deceased, his son tells that, no, I am not responsible for my father obligation, cannot say. He must take the remaining 5 lakhs and execute the contract of sale. So here the principle of active personal is death extinguishes liability is not applicable here. And suppose the contract of father, deceased father, is with reference to some service, for some construction of some completion of construction of building, writing of a paint, which the deceased alone can do, the son cannot do. Suppose A took 10,000 rupees for painting, painting or doing some service work, and A died, and the survivor has no option. They have to return the money what was received by father, deceased father, under paisa obligation, but they cannot be compelled to do specific performance. You should write the drawing, you make that painting, cannot be insisted, because law will not insist anybody to do what is impossible under section 56 of the Indian Contract Act. The doctrine of frustration or impossibility, you study, you will know about that. So these are the things. Depth in relation to tort. Next, discharge of tortious liability. What are the various conditions for discharge of tortious liability? Suppose tort is committed, aggrieved party, that is the plaintiff, files a case against the defendant. If the defendant meets the liability by paying compensation or whatever remedy he asked, then the tort is discharged. Sometimes there are so many means. He may avoid it. he may avoid it, he abandon it. There are different kinds of discharges. The student can easily understand. If time is there, I will tell discharge of liability. Next one is last one is remedies. What are the various remedies available to the remedy means when a tort is committed, it causes injury to one person or group of person. The person who suffered injury are called aggrieved parties. The aggrieved party will file a case in civil court for remedy. There are various kinds of remedies. Various kinds of remedies means abatement of nuisance, restitution of property, payment of compensation. There are so many reliefs are there. What are the various reliefs? Suppose A committed a tort, B suffered injury. That injury may be personal injury, property injury. That property injury may be with reference to movable property injury. Whatever injury he has suffered, he will have cause of action to file a case against the wrongdoer in a civil court. Then in that court, while filing a plaint, he will seek the relief. What type of relief he was? If party after arguments, the court wants to give relief, what type of relief? Sometimes he may ask injunction, sometimes he may ask specific performance, sometimes he may ask abatement of nuisance, sometimes he may ask compensation, that is damages. There are so many defenses are there. What are these various remedies? I will take up this chapter separately. This is a very good chapter. Question may be asked, remedies chapter, question may be asked, and I will take up this chapter in detail. This charts, law charts is a very big subject. A very voluminous syllabus is there. In addition to that, in some universities, two acts are added. One is the Motor Vehicles Act and other is the Consumer Protection Act. Consumer Protection Act is added. What is this Consumer Protection Act? Consumer Protection Act means our population is increasing day by day. The human needs are increasing day by day. Now today, earlier man was satisfied with little. Now man's wants are unlimited. Earlier, car was a great luxury. Now car became a necessity. So as the population increasing, the wants, human wants are increasing day by day, and touching leaps and bounds, the demand for the goods and commodities, goods and services is increasing day by day, and so many products are coming, so many companies are coming producing the good. So some goods are not qualitative, some spurious goods and all. Suppose when we purchase any article, we are called consumer. Suppose you purchase apple and eat, you are consumer of the apple. Suppose you purchase TV and enjoy, you are called consumer. Whether it is a food item or living item or non-living item, whatever you take, make use of it, you are consumer. It may be eating food, or it may be using article, or it may be taking service. When you are enjoying a cable net connection, that you are, he's a cable network man, is a service provider. When you are enjoying electricity, electricity department is your service provider. So like this, so for goods and services, if any injustice is done to the consumer, he can approach the court. Suppose in a contract act, section 76 to 123 of Indian Contract Act dealt with sale and purchase of movable goods. But this area litigation is increased. These sections 176 to 123 were deleted, repealed, and in that place Sale of Goods Act 1930 came. That Sale of Goods Act 1930 deals with all movable property purchase and sales transaction. If any seller has breached the contract, buyer could file a case. Buyer breached the contract, seller could file a case. And so these disputes relating to sale and purchase of movable goods were settled in Sale of Goods Act. If the case is filed under the Sale of Goods Act in General Court of Law, it will take like much time. So there are so many consumers, so many cases, thousands of cases are pending. In order to speed up the case, some special legislation is passed. As I told you previously, more crores of cases, 4 to 5 crore cases are pending in India. right from lowest court to the apex court, trial court to the apex court, that is Supreme Court of India. In order to clear up the cases, in order to remove the pendency of the cases, the government of India has taken so many, the governments have taken so many steps by alternative measure, by giving judicial, conferring judicial power on executives, by establishing tribunals, labor courts and others, by introducing Lok Adalat, by introducing fast track courts, and all these measures are there. So the special